Justify. Prove to be right or reasonable. Justification is at the heart of all legal and political argument. But at a time when argument itself is slave to appearances, it is time to bring back a culture of justification. Justify, a podcast on law and politics in India from the Vidhi Center for Legal Policy, hosted by Arghya Sengupta.
In just a very few years, cryptocurrency has gone from being a niche subject discussed by tech and finance pundits to being a global and kind of mainstream phenomenon worth billions of dollars. Despite high volatility in prices and lack of clarity in the regulatory framework, India's market for crypto grew at an exponential rate of 641% from July 2020 to June 2021. According to a recent study conducted by broker discovery and comparison platform Broker Chooser, India has the highest number of crypto users in the world at 10.07 crores. At the same time, Bitcoin, one such cryptocurrency, has seen a massive rise in value since the start of the war in Ukraine, given expectations that Russian oligarchs faced with a tanking ruble will pour their money into Bitcoin. A UK newspaper called cryptocurrency, and I quote, "Putin's sanctions-busting super weapon," unquote. The Ukrainian government also received over $50 million worth of donations in cryptocurrencies since the start of the war, clearly working both ways. Is the growth of the crypto industry a fad or here to stay? What kind of regulatory mechanism for crypto is going to work? And what are its geopolitical ramifications in the context of what's going on in Ukraine? To discuss these issues, I have with me Shehnaz Ahmad, Lead of Fintech at Vidhi Center for Legal Policy and one of the leading thinkers on fintech-related issues in India. Shehnaz, welcome to Justify.
Thank you, Arghya, for having me.
Great. So let's dive right in. So why, Shehnaz, is the Russian invasion of Ukraine being called the first crypto war? Is it an accurate description or is it intentionally provocative?
I think this is a very interesting issue. Now, I think the Russia-Ukraine conflict, an unfortunate incident, actually brings home or brings forth the two points or the two sides of the debate that cryptocurrency has been witnessing. Let's start with the Russian perspective, perhaps. So as we all know, there has been a lot of economic sanctions that have been imposed on Russia due to this conflict. SWIFT, which is an international payment mechanism or a messaging system for facilitating cross-border payments, has stated that it will exclude Russian banks from its ecosystem. So thereby, these economic sanctions have rendered businesses, traders, individuals in Russia in some sort of a challenging position because they are unable to transfer funds. Because of which, an alternative that a lot of them are looking at is cryptocurrency. Now, cryptocurrency is being used to transfer funds for cross-border payments, for, you know, for even for domestic purposes and all. Now, this is not something new. I mean, Western powers have always had this fear that cryptocurrency can become a way to evade economic sanctions. Russia is perhaps just an example of how this may happen going forward in the future. There has also been reports of how certain countries, specifically certain rogue nations, have used cryptocurrency to evade sanctions, especially for the purposes of investing it in their warfare. So
let me stop you there to get into some amount of detail. And I'm not an expert on this issue, and I'm guessing most listeners are not. But tell us a little bit about how crypto can help evade sanctions or evade the law. Because I see that a lot of, at least from as a general observer, cryptocurrency now is out in the open. There are a lot of exchanges, a lot of currencies. They seem to be like regular businesses. So why is it that there is this fear that cryptocurrency will be able to bypass sanctions or bypass the law?
Sure. So the idea of cryptocurrency, or rather, let's say, talk about Bitcoin, the most popular cryptocurrency, was essentially to facilitate peer-to-peer payments. Traditionally, the way financial systems or payment systems work is that transactions happen through regulated intermediaries. Regulators, policymakers regulate those intermediaries like your banks, your financial institutions. But what happens in the case of cryptocurrencies is that they facilitate peer-to-peer payments. You do not need intermediaries. So once you do not need intermediaries, intermediaries, you can have to, I mean, you can sort of facilitate peer-to-peer payments. And that is why there is no need to be a part of the global ecosystem or traditional financial system. So you can always work outside that traditional financial system. Economic sanctions don't really work because you don't need traditional, you don't need banks, you don't need financial systems to sort of facilitate payments. So I think that's where the decentralized nature of crypto facilitates that.
So tell me then, because this has actually been a raging debate, what you are saying now, the chairman of the Fed, Jerome Powell, I just saw, has also said that the conflict in Russia is underscoring the need for congressional action. So to calling for passing a law to regulate cryptocurrencies because it's a growing industry, but there is no regulatory framework. On the other hand, Brian Armstrong of the cryptocurrency exchange Coinbase, seems to be one of the larger exchanges, says that, and makes a very valid point, says that it doesn't matter if your company handles dollars, crypto, gold, real estate, or even non-financial assets, sanctions apply to all US people and businesses. So it would be a mistake to think that cryptocurrency businesses like Coinbase won't follow the law. So they will follow the law, is what he's saying. And he's saying that they screen people who sign up for their services against global watch lists. They block transactions from IP addresses which might belong to sanctioned individuals, just like any other regulated financial service businesses. So where does the truth lie? Because it seems like there is a kind of intermediary like this kind of exchange which is coming into it in crypto. So it's not that vision may have been peer-to-peer, but it seems like now there is a layer in the middle that has come out, and the layer is saying, regulate us. And if you want to put sanctions on some people, tell us and we will put sanctions on them. So is this really a false binary that's being set up?
So yes, you are correct to the extent that the whole original idea of peer-to-peer payments that was proposed, perhaps today the way it is translating is that you still have some centralized exchanges. But I think it's important when we, given the risks that are associated with crypto, and the Russian example is perhaps economic sanctions, evading economic sanctions is one way to do it. But there are the risks that are associated with it specifically in the context of money laundering, tax evasion, and there are numerous examples of it. There are numerous types of crypto assets that have come up, specifically certain crypto assets like privacy coins, which have been designed specifically to ensure that there is anonymity in the entire life cycle of the transaction. So I think the kind of concerns that come up with cryptocurrency exchanges require that they need to be regulated, at least the gatekeepers, which is your exchanges. And I think that's why it's important that this entire ecosystem functions within public policy frameworks. The more you let it remain outside, you run the risk of allowing the growth of a reckless market.
I think that's a very valid point. As we have to consider it a reality, whether folks in governments like it or not, that people are willing to trade with each other in crypto, as in we could decide tomorrow to trade with each other in hand sanitizer bottles. And that's just a function of the market. And if that has taken up some steam, then it's necessary that, as you, for reasons that you rightly said, that we bring it into the formal system, regulate it, and even bigger exchanges are saying that they're happy to be regulated and impose these sanctions. But let's look at the other side of the coin. This is the side of the coin which is, and no pun intended with coin, but this is the side which is saying that Russian oligarchs are going to now put their money into Bitcoin because the ruble is tanking, and so they want to use it as a wealth preserving mechanism. So that's why Bitcoin prices have gone up. But the other side of the coin is that lots of Ukrainians everywhere in the world are sending money back to Ukraine through crypto. And a recent report that I read said that it's to the tune of almost $50 million. And perhaps one of the reasons why this is happening is because it's so easy. It's easy to do, and it's in its design, it is transnational, right? There is no nationality that is embedded into its system. So do you think that this is a wake-up call for legacy currency systems to remain competitive? And I know that this is a slightly odd question, because if there's one thing that is a function of your sovereignty, then that is the ability to print and have a monopoly in printing a fiat currency. But given the fact that this is now under some challenge with a currency that people are accepting, that's easier to send money, particularly cross-country, then do you think that this Ukraine experience will make fiat currencies and central banks that run fiat currencies wake up and become more competitive?
Absolutely. I think the Ukraine example, as you correctly pointed out, is a good indication of the kind of efficiencies perhaps cryptocurrency or digital currencies issued by private entities can bring in certain areas where there is still inefficiencies. Now, for instance, while Ukraine talks about cryptocurrency, but I perhaps would like to bring up the case of stable coins, which cryptocurrencies have always been unpopular because of the volatility in the prices. Now, to deal with that, you have the emergence of stable coins, which are where the value is pegged to some sort of an asset, for instance, say a fiat currency. And that is why there is some amount of stability in that prices. Now, globally, various central banks have recognized that stable coins can perhaps be a good way to facilitate cross-border payments because of the efficiencies it may bring. And also we understand that currently cross-border payments are very inefficient. There are too many intermediaries. So looking at the growth of these stable coins and cryptocurrencies and the potential that it brings for is sort of bringing in efficiencies, we have central banks actually now seriously thinking about introducing what we are now calling a central bank digital currency. So definitely stable coins, cryptocurrencies are a wake-up call for central banks to start innovating and thinking what lies beyond perhaps looking at digital payments, perhaps look at a digital version of the fiat currency.
So if you were to digress for 1 minute, you said that crypto is also a wake-up call to make central banks think about digital versions of their currency. The RBI has announced that they are working on a digital rupee. The finance minister announced it. The prime minister endorsed that suggestion. How do you see this ecosystem playing out with fiat currencies that are now digital, fiat currencies which continue to remain physical, and cryptocurrencies of various types, which may be regulated, but remain non-fiat in that sense? How do you see this playing with each other if you had a crystal ball?
Sure. So obviously, I think the way I would see right now, I see an ecosystem where obviously the central bank digital currency can coexist with cryptos and stable coins. Now, one has to look at the use cases. Cryptos, no matter, at least the way it is still evolving, no matter how much it tries, it will still not be able to reach a scale that will perhaps give a sort of a competition or a threat to the fiat currency or to the existing payment ecosystem. But definitely they can make a contribution in those places where there is inefficiencies, where perhaps it has been difficult for traditional players or even for central banks to go, like for instance, cross-border payments. But at the same time, I do think that their ecosystem, both stable coins, cryptocurrencies and CBDCs can coexist in a manner with each one having a different use case. And I think making more efficient payments is what perhaps the goal is, what we are looking at.
That's right. And I think the Ukraine is a wake-up call for the whole world and for central banks particularly, and those who work on payment systems, that it's time, as Shehnaz said, to not allow this market to remain reckless, but bring it in, capitalize on its advantages, and ensure that its basic design, which is that of being a public ledger, where there is transparency that is embedded, its basic design is made use of in ensuring that that the nefarious effects of crypto in terms of secrecy and what all can go on in the shadows are weeded out. So I think that's really the lesson that's coming out, that bring it in, regulate it. But that I think is a good segue to what next for crypto in India, because India's policy response to crypto has been somewhat curious. Because it initially, from my reading, sought to ban crypto assets and now seems to be moving towards regulation. There was a bill that was floated, the Cryptocurrency and Regulation of Official Digital Currency Bill, which was intended to be introduced but has not been introduced. But the budget made an announcement to tax cryptocurrency. The RBI perhaps has been the most consistent in this, that it has maintained that trading of crypto assets, whether currency or any other assets, should be illegal in all forms. And that has been at least a clear position that has been taken. But Otherwise, if you take the entire policy ecosystem, it seems to be a lack of policy clarity 101, where one arm is saying we are going to tax crypto, someone else is going to say ban crypto, and there are always calls to say that we'll regulate crypto. So what is happening and how does this regulatory framework look like developing? Or I can't even call it a regulatory framework, but how does this framework on how we think about crypto look like developing in the next year?
Sure. I think, yes, you're right to the extent that I think for India, there has been a lot of uncertainty in terms of how crypto assets will be regulated. The tax aspect obviously is a welcome move to the extent it clarified the taxation of crypto assets. But I think the flip-flop that the government is sort of doing in so far as their cryptocurrency policy position is concerned has brought in more uncertainty for businesses and I think putting investors at a risk. And as you had already mentioned, India perhaps is one of the countries with a huge customer base. And we have seen the markets have risen exponentially in the last couple of years, because of which I think it's extremely important that we sort of adopt a framework to regulate cryptocurrencies. Now, what is happening globally is that it's obviously the way the cryptocurrency market evolves, there are various entities, there is no underlying asset here, and it's very different from how currently the financial market or financial regulatory architecture operates. So I think it's important, at least in the first rung or first phase of regulation that we are looking at, that we need to regulate these gatekeepers or intermediaries, that is your exchanges. Globally, you have standard setting bodies which have recommended time and again that you need to have anti-money laundering frameworks for cryptocurrency related transactions, and somehow India has not been able to implement it. So I think this is definitely a very important or an important moment for India that we set out the policy position for cryptocurrency, and I'm hoping this is what the government will perhaps try and do in a bill to regulate the sector.
So Shehnaz, you have written a great paper as an on cryptocurrency regulation in India, arguing that it should be regulated and not be banned. And you said that in phase one, the regulation should be of the exchanges. So can you get into a little bit of detail, particularly on two points? As in, one is that what does the ecosystem look like in terms of how many exchanges are there, and do all transactions happen through exchanges or are there peer-to-peer transactions as well? Number one. And when you say regulate, regulate in what way? I think these are two questions that come up.
Sure. So yes, currently the way the transactions happen is that you have a centralized exchange, which is, there are a couple of exchanges around 15 to 20 exchanges, well-known exchanges in India that exist, which provides a centralized platform where buyers and sellers can come and trade. There are also exchanges which allow peer-to-peer transfers, but at the same time, there is still a platform there. So most of these happens through a centralized exchanges. So in the framework that we had suggested in our report, what we say is that you need to bring in this gatekeepers, intermediaries into your regulatory framework, which is your exchanges. Then there are also intermediaries which provide you services like custody services to hold your private keys. There are intermediaries which perhaps also provide you investment advice. So these are the financial intermediaries which needs to be regulated in the first phase is what we argue. The second thing that we also look at is also the possibility of regulating the issuers of certain types of crypto assets, which is perhaps something like a stable coin. Now, the problem is that in India, we have all tried to pigeonhole or categorize crypto assets as one type of asset class. So that is why there has always been a debate whether it's a security, whether it's a commodity. But when you look at the nature of crypto assets, it's very difficult to categorize them into one asset class. So what we have suggested is that you need to think of it as a separate asset class. You need to have a new regulatory framework, a bespoke law for crypto assets. You need to regulate your intermediaries. You need to think about regulating certain issuers. And you need to rely on the expertise of both the Securities and Exchange Regulator in India, as well as the Reserve Bank of India, with SEBI remaining responsible for market conduct regulation and RBI remaining responsible for prudential regulation.
So I think that what you've laid out is very comprehensive. So regulate the exchanges, in terms of ensuring transparency of what all goes on in the exchanges themselves, all the transactions that take place, and also in terms of don't try and think about making it or comparing it to existing things, but recognize that it is something new. But given that, do you see that this current uncertainty that exists, is it just a traditional governmental mindset of being afraid of something new? Or is there also some truth to the fact that crypto is used for certain nefarious activities, whether it be money laundering, whether it be drug trafficking, or in some sense, is crypto the new hawala?
Yeah. No, I think there are definitely good reasons as to why the government perhaps has not been very proactive in going and starting to regulate it. There is evidence of how cryptocurrencies are used for various nefarious activities, as you have pointed out. But I think that is all the more reason why perhaps you need to regulate it. And India is perhaps not just the only country. I mean, globally also, you have regulators which are still trying to grapple and understand the nuances of it. I think what is happening essentially is that right now most regulators are trying to still understand how the market is evolving, and they don't want to perhaps take a position on this for the fear of legitimizing that entire crypto ecosystem. And I think that's where the problem arises. For the fear of legitimizing, we are perhaps allowing the growth of a crypto economy, which perhaps tomorrow might reach a stage where it will even be difficult to regulate it.
Yeah, so I think this is always the traditional tale that no point in getting into it after it's become so big that you can't do anything about it. You get into it and understand it first, and then you can take a call. So my last set of questions is around the impact of crypto on small traders and small investors. A survey conducted by NORC in the US found that the average cryptocurrency trader is under 40. Does not have a college degree. That's 55% of them don't have a college degree. And over a third have household incomes under $60,000 annually. Okay. So you are talking of people who are nowhere near the top of the pyramid, okay, who are using this. At the same time, as we have seen, anyone who watches any kind of television in India or is on YouTube for any length of time will find that crypto exchanges in India are on an advertising overdrive. Okay. Whether it be during the T20 World Cup, or in any other major sporting event. Now I see that there are those statutory warnings that also seem to come when crypto advertisements are issued. Now, given the fact that there is a huge rise of interest in crypto, and a lot of our listeners would perhaps be weighing their options after this, listening to this as to whether to get in there or not, what is the impact of crypto on small citizen investors and traders at this point of time in India? Do you think that it's wise to get in, wait for things to evolve? And just to caveat that whatever you say here will not count as legal advice.
Sure. So I think it's important that people invest in this asset class with full information. Right now, I think a lot of people are getting into this ecosystem, if I may use the word, I mean, just for the fear of missing out. A lot of people think that perhaps it is easy to make quick money using cryptocurrencies. And I think that perhaps is a very wrong way to look at it. And I think this is also the reason why it has become very important that there is full disclosure of the kind of risks that comes with crypto assets. Now, one cannot think about crypto assets as investments in shares or securities market, which is highly regulated. So before, I think what I perhaps would like to say is that for anyone who's trying to understand or get into the ecosystem, it's important to understand how, which currency, which crypto coin to invest in, how it has performed in the last couple of years or last couple of months. Also be aware of the fact that, you know, when you need to liquidate your positions, also be aware of the fact that this is a speculative asset. So it is very important to keep, I think, these considerations in mind when one is investing in this particular sector.
I think that makes a lot of sense, because I myself was thinking about it, because some of these exchanges are actually very easy to use. You can log in immediately, put a small amount of money and see what happens. And I think that's how they're trying to lure you in. But as with any investment, I think Shehnaz has some words of wisdom for everybody, that we need full information as to what it can or cannot get. Cannot bring us, and there are no shortcuts to easy money. So if it's only about getting rich fast, then perhaps crypto is as good as the share market, which is as good as working hard on whatever you're doing. Thanks very much, Shehnaz. This has been a really wide ranging talk, right from Ukraine to the Reserve Bank of India. I think there is crypto is a reality. I think it's better that we recognize this reality and regulate it, rather than leave it out there in the cold till it becomes too big and then we don't know what we have created. Thank you so much, Shehnaz, for sharing your thoughts on this issue with us.
Thank you so much, Arghya. It's a pleasure speaking to you.
Last week's CLATTR question was about the connection between Section 54 of the NDPS Act and the construction of a reservoir leading to the flooding of a coal mine. We weren't really flooded with answers. It seemed like it was a little tough for everybody. But the answer is strict liability. Section 54 of the NDPS Act has strict liability, and the famous case of a reservoir leading to the flooding of a coal mine is, of course, Rylands v. Fletcher. Let's hope that we get right answers next time. I was going to say more right answers, but let's hope we get some right answers next time. And particularly for our law students, do put your thinking caps on. A very exciting gift awaits. Today's question, because of the episode, is on the origins of the technology underlying cryptocurrency. Cryptocurrency is secured through cryptography, and some of the cryptography used in cryptocurrency was developed for the use of the military. The government of the US tried to put restrictions on cryptography, similar to some of those restrictions imposed on weapons. In this respect, a civilian tried to secure the right to use cryptography through seminal litigation. What was the judgment, and what was the primary legal ground on which it is based, which will get you some extra points? Do write in with your answers to justify@vidhilegalpolicy.in. All right answers have a chance to win a very special gift. And since this episode was about cryptocurrency, the song today is dedicated to my mother because it's one of her favorites, Money, Money, Money by ABBA. Enjoy listening to it. Adjourned.
I work all night, I work all day to pay the bills I have to pay. Hey, need said. And still there never seems to be a single penny left for me. That's you.
If you enjoyed listening to this podcast, follow us on Twitter @Vidhi_India for regular updates. We are on SoundCloud and Spotify as Vidhi Center for Legal Policies Podcast. You can also listen to us on Google Podcasts or iTunes. Email us at justify@vidhilegalpolicy.in to share your comments and feedback on this episode.